My name is Spencer from the University of Wisconsin, and I'm going to talk with you about diabetic retinopathy and chronic vision loss. To start the talk, I'll provide some background on diabetic retinopathy and discuss its progression. Next, we'll touch on screening and treatment, and lastly, we'll talk about vision loss attributed to diabetic retinopathy. Diabetic retinopathy is a leading cause of vision loss in individuals with both type 1 and type 2 diabetes mellitus. In addition, it affects at least 80% of individuals who have had diabetes for 20 or more years. With rising rates of obesity and diabetes, the number of people with diabetic retinopathy is expected to rise as well. Of note, diabetes can also manifest in the eye as early cataracts, macular edema, neovascular glaucoma, central and branch retinal vein occlusion, among other findings. Diabetic retinopathy is due to chronic hyperglycemia causing damage to the retinal vasculature and poor perfusion. The ischemic tissue releases vascular endothelial growth factor, or VEGF, which initially leads to abnormal leakage of fluid into the retina, and later the proliferation of blood vessels. The first manifestation of diabetic retinopathy is called non-proliferative diabetic retinopathy. Here, we have a wide-field photograph of a left eye with non-proliferative diabetic retinopathy containing microaneurysms, which are small bulges in the blood vessels. Microaneurysms have a tendency to leak fluid, which may cause swelling within the macula. Here is another left eye with non-proliferative diabetic retinopathy. In addition to the microaneurysms, we also see dot hemorrhages, cotton wool spots, and venous beading. The cotton wool spots are due to ischemia causing infarctions of the retina's nerve fiber layer. The final stage of diabetic retinopathy is proliferative diabetic retinopathy. This is characterized by new blood vessels on the surface of the retina and/or within the vitreous. These new blood vessels are prone to leaking and bleeding because they're weak and fragile. The leaking blood vessels can cause hemorrhages and macular edema, which both can affect the vision. In addition, an inflammatory response triggers scar tissue formation, which can cause traction on the retina with subsequent detachments and permanent vision loss. Here, we see proliferative blood vessels, especially near the optic nerves. There's also an abundance of microaneurysms. As mentioned, there may also be vitreous hemorrhages, scar tissue, and retinal detachments, which are not seen in these photos. A critical aspect of limiting the visual sequelae of diabetic retinopathy is screening, because the first stages of the disease are often asymptomatic. Specifically, type 1 diabetics should begin annual screening within 3 to 5 years of disease onset. Type 2 diabetics should begin annual exams shortly after their diagnosis. These exams should include a comprehensive dilated exam to assess for any features of diabetic retinopathy or other ocular manifestations of diabetes. In addition, fluorescein angiography and/or macular OCT can supplement the exam. Lastly, there should be a discussion about blood sugar and blood pressure control, and it is critical to be in close contact with a patient's primary care provider if there are any concerns over their blood sugar or blood pressure regimen. As I mentioned, imaging is a common adjunct to a thorough clinical exam. OCT imaging provides cross-sectional images of the retina, which give both qualitative and quantitative data. Specifically, we can assess for edema, epiretinal membranes, vitreoretinal traction, and the health of the individual retinal cell layers. Fluorescein angiography is another imaging technique, which allows the provider to assess for fluid leakage and retinal perfusion. However, it does require IV contrast. Next, I would like to discuss treatments for diabetic retinopathy. In all patients with diabetic retinopathy, a critical aspect of treatment is blood sugar and blood pressure control to prevent disease progression. Specifically, patients should aim for a hemoglobin A1C of less than 7% and blood pressures within the normal range for their age. In addition to strict blood pressure and blood sugar control, patients with non-proliferative diabetic retinopathy with edema may be treated with intravitreal anti-VEGF injections to combat the abnormal VEGF and leaky vessels of diabetic retinopathy. Other treatments for macular edema include intravitreal steroids and focal laser. Proliferative diabetic retinopathy can be treated with pan-retinal photocoagulation, intravitreal anti-VEGF injections, and may even require vitrectomy for manifestations like vitreous hemorrhage, epiretinal membranes, and retinal detachments. Panretinal photocoagulation works by reducing metabolic oxygen demands of the retina and VEGF production, which reduces abnormal blood vessel proliferation. It also helps prevent tractional retinal detachments. Lastly, I want to talk about vision loss in diabetic retinopathy. However, as I mentioned before, the early stages of disease are often asymptomatic. If the disease progresses to proliferative diabetic retinopathy, patients with vitreous hemorrhages can have blurry vision. Patients with tractional retinal detachments can develop the classic symptoms of flashes, floaters, a falling curtain, and/or complete monocular vision loss. Their subsequent visual acuity depends largely on macular involvement of the retinal detachment. Leaky vessels and fluid can also cause diabetic macular edema, which can cause waviness in the vision, known as metamorphopsia, and decreased visual acuity. Remarkably, only 60% of patients with diabetes receive an annual eye exam. However, it is essential to screen patients regularly, as early intervention is critical to preventing non-reversible vision loss. Fortunately, panretinal photocoagulation and intravitreal anti-VEGF injections are so effective that they have remarkably reduced the incidence of severe vision loss due to diabetic retinopathy.